All right, where's the last part? That's all, folks. Okay. Welcome. This is the beginning. Now, I do have to say, watching this has really taken me back, probably where the white hair is coming from. The mouse with the tall hat, he was representing what famous character? Thank you. I gave you that answer. Okay. I remember, believe it or not, I actually remember watching this with my dad a long time ago, but good memories. Well, we want to welcome you here to our Shamrock and Roll SBA Stage Band Concert. I think we're going to be in for an incredible evening. And as we begin, I want us to bow our heads and let's begin with a word of prayer. Lord, tonight as we celebrate with music and the talents of our kids, we want to thank you for those blessings. As we enjoy the music, Lord, help us to have a good time together. In your name, amen. All right, at this time, let us welcome Mr. Don Huff to the stage.
Good evening and welcome. It's been a busy 4 weeks, yeah? This is kind of the fifth concert in a little less than 4 weeks. And I was thinking today, as I was getting ready to come here, we're actually, you know, we're doing an Irish Journey season this year, and this actually marks the halfway point. There's 8 concerts in that series, and this is the 4th one, so we're halfway through. There's one person behind me that's gone on that journey with me that's been all 4 of those concerts, and that's Zaid. So he's played all 4 of them, so good job, Zaid. We started with the Star of County Down, an Irish ballad set near Bainbridge in County Down, Ireland. It's a typical love song that ends with the guy losing the girl when she immigrates to America. The tune is also known as the hymn tune Kingsfold, which is the tune used for the hymn I Heard the Voice of Jesus Say. I'd like to welcome tonight, especially welcome to our Chicago Steve Martin, not to be confused with the other banjo playing Steve Martin of Hollywood fame. Can you give Steve a welcome? It's kind of a last minute. We really needed a whistle player for our concert last night. And once I said, hey, any chance in 2 weeks you can come down and play that for us? He said, sure. And I said, well, you're going to be here. You should come and play our jazz band concert the next night. So I'm glad it worked out. And we'll talk a little bit more about it later. But his fingerprint is kind of over everything we do tonight. He helps me out, and I'll explain as we go through all the things. We started with a piece that he actually arranged for stage band that we premiered in 2018, that Star of County Down. So it's cool that he can be here tonight. When I started planning our Celtic season, and specifically this concert, I had the title Celtic Jazz in mind. But then Christy Doria, we were thinking about concerts this year, and she came up with the title for our Christmas concert, I Wish You a Merry Christmas. And that was just so good that I got to compete with that, you know, how am I going to get a title? So I was watching the movie on Netflix called The River Dance. It's Netflix original called Riverdance, The Animated Adventure. I highly recommend watching it if you haven't seen it. But during that movie, in the little village town there, there's a store called Shamrock and Roll, and it's like the record store where you go buy CDs and records and stuff. So I was like, oh, that's a great name for a concert. So I thought that was clever, so that's where the name came from. Most of our music tonight are jazz ensemble songs that have a connection to either Ireland or a Celtic connection of some sort. However, the next song, Celtic Air, is the most uniquely and original Celtic jazz thing we're going to play tonight. It's a really, really great chart. I hope you enjoy it, and thanks for being here. Here is Celtic Air. Thank you. Isn't that a cool piece? One more hand for solos by Mia and Philip. Fields of Gold is a song written and performed by the English musician known as Sting. The lyrics of the song describe Sting's view from his 16th century Wiltshire manor house in England. Sting states, "In England, our house is surrounded by barley fields, and in the summer, it's fascinating to watch the wind moving over the shimmering surface like waves of an ocean of gold." Fields of Gold. And Paul Papiano. In 1963, Canadian jazz trumpeter Maynard Ferguson released his album, The New Sounds of the Maynard Ferguson and His Orchestra. The last track on this album was his rendition of the traditional Irish air, Danny Boy, which uses the traditional tune, the Londonderry air. This folk tune originated in County Londonderry. Both this county and the city with the same name is subject to the Derry-Londonderry name dispute, with the Londonderry name preferred by the Unionist and Derry by the Nationalist. High School Band and Choir will be performing a concert in this city and spending a night here on our trip coming up to Ireland. I came across Maynard Ferguson's arrangement of Danny Boy last spring and thought this would be a great challenge for Zaid. He accepted the challenge and learned it over the summer. Here now is Maynard Ferguson's arrangement of Danny Boy featuring Zaid McIntosh on trumpet. One more hand for Zaid. The next tune, Greener Pastures, is the Jazz Ensemble original that I would categorize as smooth jazz. It'll feature Mia Kamanzog at soprano sax and Noah Hahn on the piano. I programmed this smooth jazz original tonight for a couple reasons. One, to showcase Mia on the soprano sax, and two, because Ireland is known for its greenness. Did you know the reason for this? Is because the country sits smack dab in the middle of the Gulf Stream, which brings warm water from Mexico to Ireland, which keeps things mild as Ireland rarely sees snow. They do experience somewhere between 123 to 194 rainy days a year. Naturally, the more rain there is, the lusher the green grass grows, hence why Ireland is called the Emerald Isle. Let's take a moment and look back at where these different phrases began. First, in the Bible, Psalm 23, to lie down in green pastures. In the first BC, it's quoted, the harvest is always richer in another man's field. The 1900s saw the term, grass is always greener in the other fellow's yard. Johnny Cash coined the phrase 40 shades of green with his 1961 song, which was inspired by his trip to Ireland in 1959. In 1970, the phrase in search of greener pastures came about. And lastly, the term Emerald Isle was first used in a poem by Belfast-born William Brennan. He helped found the Society of the United Irishmen, which led to the rebellion of 1798. Here's an excerpt from his poem. Alas, the poor Aaron that some are still seen, who would dye the grass red from the hatred to green. Yet, oh, when you're up and they're down, let them live. Then yield them that mercy which they would not give. Arm of Aaron, be strong, but gentle as brave, and uplifted to strike, be still ready to save. Let no feeling of vengeance presume to defile the cause of, or men of, the Emerald Isle. Here is Greener Pastures.
Thank you.
was a big piece, huh? Yeah. Some different style than we normally do, for sure. So it's my pleasure now to introduce Steve Martin to do his first set tonight. I first learned about Steve Martin, I think, around the year 2000. He came and did a Vespers at Centerville on his trumpet. Just a couple years after that, when I took a group of kids to Andrews for band festival, we ended up rooming together. And many, many late nights of talking band talk. When you get another together with another band director, it's a good time. And at that time, I had just, I think, done our first Celtic concert here at Spring Valley, and he was just getting into Celtic music at the same time, so even more stuff to talk about. And then after that, at least twice, I've taken the band from here up to Chicago, and we played at the school that he's taught at for how many years?
Just finished 40.
40 years at North Shore Junior Academy. Yeah, 40 years. Give him applause. Yeah. It feels like just the last couple of years, but probably has been 5, 6, 7, 8 years, he's really become very involved with helping arrange different things. As our program has grown, I have new ideas, and the music doesn't exist in sheet music form, so I often turn to him. So tonight alone, let me just list kind of where his fingerprints are on the concert. First of all, he composed our opening song, our arrangement of The Star of County Down. He transcribed out the improv solos for Celtic Air. He transcribed out the improv solos for Greener Pastures that Mia just did. He arranged or transcribed Yes, We Have No Bananas for our Woodwind Quintet that started this year. He's made all the alto sax and bass clarinet parts. He created the full score for Loch Lomond that I'll talk about later. And as not even on my list, he made Michael Doolin a more exciting Barry Sax part for In the Mood. So that's just a few, it's kind of an example of what he does from concert to concert for us. I'm so happy he can be here tonight. And one thing I've asked Steve to do tonight is just to let kind of educate you a little bit on what Irish session music is. So when I first met him and got to know him, he wasn't involved in that. And then over the last, I don't know, 12, 13 years or something like that, he's really become active on the Irish session scene in Chicago. And to me, someone who's interested in Celtic music and stuff, I find it fascinating. And actually, again, last night, probably 30 minutes, I was asking him questions about it. So I want him to tell you a little bit about his journey into Irish session music, and he's going to do a couple, three different sets tonight, which is kind of an example of what that type of music's like. So, ladies and gentlemen, Steve Martin.
Thank you very much. Such a nice gesture for him to invite me to come over a couple weeks ago. I was thrilled. I had an open weekend. My life these days are quite hectic, but I was so thrilled that I could come. It's always a treat to get over here and play music with your groups, whether it's the orchestra or the jazz band or whatever. It's always a lot of fun, and I appreciate all the work you send me to write music. You know, I've been creating music since I was a teenager, where I picked up the banjo first when I was 10, and then my grandmother inspired me to play the guitar, and that's when it started taking off with the arranging part. And my teacher that was on the banjo gave me some stuff that I didn't see again until I got to college about part writing, harmony, and how to build a solo on an instrument. And I can never thank him enough for what he did for me. And being my 40th year teaching, I'll talk maybe on the next thing. I want to get to kind of the Celtic thing at this point. And I haven't always been around Celtic music. I discovered it in the fall of 2010. One of my church member friends came to me and says, I work at a bank downtown, and I have a buddy who plays the banjo. You guys have to meet. So he took me to a place called O'Shaughnessy's, and I experienced something I had never heard in my life. I don't know how I missed it. Chicago is full of Irish people and Irish places to play and restaurants and pubs and everything. But somehow I just overlooked it or just never had the connection to make it happen. And when I walked into this place, there was a circle of people that had things like fiddles, whistles, concertinas, guitars, banjos, sometimes a harp, and the baran, which is the drum, and sometimes, if you are lucky, someone will show up with illan pipes, which is the Irish version of bagpipes. You have to sit to play those, not like the Scottish ones where you're standing and holding them. I was just in awe and immediately addicted to it. It was just in my blood. And I have proof from 23andMe and Ancestry.com. My DNA showed, they sent me a map, and it was all the islands right there. That's it. And when they'll oftentimes, someone will reach out and say, hey, I think you're a cousin of mine. And they'll have our thing side by side. Well, mine is 100% Northern Europe. And there's always a little bit of something else somewhere, Asia or South Saharan Africa or something else. But mine, 100%. I must be a purebred, I guess. I don't know. But anyway, that music just struck a tune in my heart that I just couldn't ignore. And I started asking all these folks, what is this stuff? You know, how do I find out this music? Well, you just sit and come to these sessions. They call them sessions, like a jam session. They sit in a circle and play for about 3 hours. And they play three tunes in a row, like medley style. And each one is only about 16 bars long, usually. And so they do those three times. So it's 3, 3, 3. And I brought a little recorder with me to the next one when I was aware of what was going on and recorded the night. And I went back home and I said, oh, I like this one. And I have this thing that I create all Donald's arrangements and compositions he orders from me on this program called Sibelius. And you can create anything you want musically and publish it. And so I found out that I learned it better if I had to notate the things out. I could hear by ear the melodies they were playing, and I could jot it down into this program and make a whole chart for myself. And then I brought it back to the next week, and I said, I like this set. By the way, what are the names of these tunes? And they looked at it and said, we don't read music. I'm like, okay. And then I took it, and I hummed the first few notes. Oh, that. You know, that's Tatterjack Walsh. Or, you know, the Lilting Banshee or whatever it was, you know. And they kind of frowned. I found out real quick. They didn't like it for you to bring music. This is a tradition for thousands of years of being passed down from generation to generation, these tunes. There are literally thousands of them. I've memorized about 400 to 500 of them because they won't let me bring the music. And I love them so much. And I learned them and got to where I could play them and then just, you know, go to the session, sit down and play. And it's just so much fun. It's almost like a family thing. You get to know each other and just form a bond. And then when you see each other somewhere else, it's like, oh yeah, you know, come back next Sunday. I want to see you again, you know. There's this connection. It's so much fun. And back in Ireland, which I haven't been to yet, I had a goal to get there in 2020 summer, but, oh, man, that crazy pandemic got in the way. So I'm putting it off, but I'm going to try and get there next year if I can. And I hear from all my buddies who are from there, who live in Chicago, that I play with, this is like a family affair. Everybody comes together and in these places where they, you know, like restaurants, you know, and people eat and drink and listen to the music. And it's quiet. They listen to the music. It's not a bunch of chattering and you're like in the background. They listen intently at what you're doing. And it's just a whole different world. And I've been so glad that I ran into this fellow. His name was Pat Quinn, the other banjo player that I met that night. And he was the one that gave me the kickstart. And there's another guy that had a big influence on me as well. I'll talk about on the next set. With the concertina. But here's a banjo medley, or set, as they would call it. The first one I'm going to do is called The Green Gates. The second one is written by a buddy of mine, Morris Lennon, called The Golden Stud. And then the last one, what was the last one? Oh, Swinging on the Gate. Hope I can remember them while I'm playing. Thank you.
Songs are linked to Belfast, Northern Ireland. We learned last Sunday night at the concert that the 1920s hit song, Yes We Have No Bananas, was the theme song of the outdoor relief protest in Belfast in 1932. It was a unique example of both Protestants and Catholics in Northern Ireland protesting together, and this song was used because it was one of the few non-political songs both communities knew. The song also lent its title to a book about the Depression in Belfast. Tonight, let me tell you the history of the song itself. Actually, I'll let the author of the song, Frank Silver, explain it in his own words in an interview that he did with Time magazine. He says, I am an American of Jewish ancestry with a wife and a young son. About a year ago, my little orchestra was playing at the Long Island Hotel. To and from the hotel, I would stop at a fruit stand owned by a Greek who began every sentence with yes. The jingle of his idiom haunted me and my friend Khan. Finally, I wrote this verse and Khan fitted it with the tune. It is speculated that the shopkeeper who said, yes, we have no bananas, and inspired this song may have been one of the many affected by a worldwide crash in the banana crop caused by the Panama disease during that time. The song title has been resurrected on many occasions, including during the rationing in the United Kingdom during World War II, when the British government banned imports of bananas for 5 years. Shop owners put signs stating, yes, we have no bananas in their shop windows, keeping up with the war spirit. Listen to this sentence. In 1923, three different recordings of this hit song reached the top 25 on the charts, with two different recordings hitting number one for a total of 7 weeks combined. So it was the song was a big deal in 1923. I must say that when we started working on this song at the beginning of the year, the band was a bit, there was speculation in the air. I could tell, what is this? What is this all about? Now I think it's one of their favorite songs. The summer when I was planning the concert, I discovered that I knew the band arrangement because we had done that with Praise Orchestra a few years ago that we did last Sunday night. But I discovered on YouTube this Benny Goodman covered this song. I sent a YouTube example to Steve, and he crafted us our own arrangement that will premiere tonight based on Louis Prima's recording from Beepin' and a Boppin', recorded between 1949 and 1954. So here is the jazz version of Yes, We Have No Bananas, sung by Mia Kabanzak.
Thank you. Yes, we have no bananas. We have no bananas today. Got string beans and onions and big juicy lemons and all kinds of fruit and say. We've got an old fashioned tomato, a Long Island potato. Oh yes, we have no bananas. We have no bananas today. There's a fruit man on our street whose name is Mr. Peach, and he keeps good things to eat, but you should hear him speak. When you ask him anything, he never answers no. He just yeses you to death and then he takes your dough. Oh yes, we know gotta know banana. We know gotta know banana today. We got a little beans and the bigger beans and the red beans and the white beans and all kinds of beans and say. We've got an old fashioned salami. We even got a Brooklyn pastrami. Oh yes, we know gotta the banana. We know gotta banana today. Business got so good with him, he wrote home to say, send Pasquale, Nick, and Jim, I need help right away. When he got them in the store, there was fun, you bet. Someone asked for bananas, and then the whole quartet. Oh yes, we have no bananas. We have no bananas today. We have cabbage, but we got no bananas today.
Who asked you for bananas anyway?
Who asked you?
I only want a hot dog sandwich.
Hot dogs are better than bananas.
I always say,
ain't it?
Oh yes, we have no bananas. We have no bananas today.
Makes me happy. We also learned last Sunday night that during the Great Potato Famine of the 1800s, people poured into Belfast in search of work at the two of the world's biggest and largest shipyards. Following the sinking of the Titanic, the city of Belfast was left in mourning, kind of a topic they didn't talk about for a long time. It wasn't actually until the early 2000s that the city embraced the tragedy and created the Titanic Experience Museum and capitalized on it to bring in tourism when Northern Ireland opened up for tourism after the end of the 30-year troubles. The 1997 blockbuster hit film Titanic brought a renewed interest in the story of the Titanic, and as we know, James Horner's musical score was a big part of this. The story goes that producer James Cameron wrote Titanic while listening to the Irish New Age musician Enya. But after Enya turned him down, he chose composer James Horner. Cameron didn't want any vocal songs in the film, but Horner wrote the end theme, My Heart Will Go On, in secret with Will Jennings. He got Celine Dion to record a demo, and the rest is history. Cameron loved it, and it became Celine Dion's theme song from that point on. With the recent Titanic submersible accident this past summer, there has been, again, a renewed interest in all things Titanic. I'm thankful that Mia was able to sing the last song, but she's been sick and had voice issues, so she's not gonna try to attempt this huge song by Celine Dion tonight. But we will do it later in the year, I promise, with her singing it because she sounds great on it. Tonight, though, Steve Martin's gonna fill in on the vocal part on flute. So please welcome Steve Martin back to the stage. Here is My Heart Will Go On.
No.
Oh, here we go. I just, before we start, have to give a tribute to Mia. She reached out and gave a blessing on my flute, from her voice to my flute. So I hate taking parts from, but thank you.
Thank you.
I don't have anything specific to say before this next song, except Steve's going to come up and play his concertina for you. But while he's getting ready, I think I should just recognize a couple of members of the group. First of all, I think we did play for Chapel on Friday, but besides that, this is Joelle's first concert, and Camden and Rodell's first concert with stage band, yes? Yeah. Over here on Vibes, Chanel's first concert with us. Yeah. And for me personally, it's kind of a big deal. My son jumped in a couple weeks in, so my son William over there on for the other trombone. Yeah, let's hear it for him. Steve Martin, concertina.
Can I talk?
All right, kind of catch my breath. Thankfully, I don't have to breathe to play this. It breathes on its own. This is a concertina, specifically the Anglo style. And what that means is it's not the English style. The English have a concertina, so when you push a button down and push the bellows, you get one note. When you pull, you get the same note. But on mine, you don't. So I have to remember, is that next note a push or a pull? But at any rate, I met John Williams. There's a lot of John Williams, I know. Classical guitar, the guy who wrote Star Wars, all that. You know, there's a DJ on WGN. But this John Williams is pretty special. His parents come from Ireland. But he grew up in the Chicago area and learned to play the accordion and eventually the piano accordion first, I understand. And then he went to the button accordion, which is different. It doesn't have the piano keys. It has about three rows of these little round buttons about this big on one side and some other keys on the left. And it's a different kind of instrument, but it's in the bellow family. But he also plays the concertina. And he doesn't just play these. He plays them at world-class level. He's the only American who has won the All-Ireland, which is like the Olympics in Irish music and dance and arts, 5 times. And on these different instruments, the concertina and this button accordion. And I'm proud to say I'm a friend of his and colleague. We've performed together a lot over the years. I met him in 2012 for the first time in one of these sessions. I went from that O'Shaughnessy's to a different place to play, and then there was a fiddler there that said, you got to meet John Williams. He's over at Tommy Nevin's. And so at that time, I went over to meet him, and I came into the session. It was a Wednesday night, and I sat down. I put my banjo, and at that time, I had only been into the Irish music 2 years, so I didn't have a lot under my belt yet, but I had a few things. I thought I could try and give it my best effort. And I had a mandolin. That's what I had really stuck to because of the fingering. You see, when these stringed instrument players get together in these Irish sessions, they tune all their instruments the same. The fiddle is just the same tuning as the mandolin. Their banjo players, which are playing on a 4-string tenor, usually. My 5-string's a weirdo, but they tune their banjo to the same tuning as the violin, but just an octave down. So they can all look at each other's hands. They don't have to read music. They can just look at each other's hands and see what's going on and follow that. And at any rate, I was there with my 5-string. It's kind of an oddball. And then, and I had my mandolin and I had a tin whistle. And those were my go-to instruments. I only knew about maybe 10 songs on my banjo. So I just had it parked here just in case one of those tunes came along. And sat on the mandolin most of the night. Well, the first couple hours, I only knew maybe 2 or 3 tunes. And so I just kind of strummed the chords. I was good enough with my ear to keep up with that. And then on the last hour, I pulled out maybe a dozen tunes I knew from that. But they were all basically on the tin whistle or the mandolin. And then at the end of the night, session's over, everybody's packing up. And then I reached over to put my banjo away. And John came walked on over and says, "Hey, Steve." He says, "I never saw you touch the banjo the whole night. Why not?" I said, "Well, you didn't play the tunes that I know on it." And he says, "Oh, well, I want to hear you play something on it. Can you give me your best party tune? So I played the Foggy Mountain Breakdown, and the whole place went nuts. And John was just like dancing around. He couldn't contain himself. And he said, oh, do another one, you know. And so it was kind of went on a little bit like that. But that was the strike of a friendship. Now, it's been over 10 years now that we've had, and we've done a lot of gigs since then. I got better. I learned more. Now I can play the tunes on pretty much anything I get my hands on. But I had a real treat. My highest treat with him was when the St. Patrick's Church in Chicago, it's right off the expressway. If you know where you're looking, you can see it on the way by on the Kennedy Expressway. Had a yearly event they called Shamsa Nagal, which in Gaelic is basically Irish music celebration. And they would play about 2.5 hours of music, Irish music, that was composed and choreographed to a symphony orchestra and a choir. And I got hired to be at one of these. In 2019, I think, was the one. Yeah, 2019. It was held at the Auditorium Theater, which, if any of you are acquainted with the Chicago area, Auditorium Theater was one of the first big venues. It was where the Chicago Symphony had their home first, and then they eventually built the orchestra hall later on Michigan Avenue. And there was probably around 3,000 people there that night. And I was sitting right here. The conductor was right there, and to my side here was there was a fiddler, Liz Carroll, and then John Williams right here on his accordion stuff, Jimmy Moore here on his guitar, and there was a piper, I can't remember his name. And we were the trad band, the traditional Irish band. You know, we had all the traditional instruments. Behind us was a full symphony orchestra with winds and strings and everything. Behind them was a 60-piece choir. Talk about a sound. I was in heaven. I was sitting right smack in front of all of it, right in the middle. And I was just enjoying the whole night, just listening to what was going on around me, as well as playing too. But it was amazing. And I can't thank John enough. He taught me so much about the Irish culture and the music and the history of the land. And things that I would never have picked up anywhere else. We'd always get on these chats in the car on the way to a place to play. And so anyway, he asked me one day, he said, hey, Steve, you ever thought about learning the concertina? And I said, yeah, I've been watching you doing that. And he knew that I played quite a few instruments. And I said, I think I'm going to bite the bullet. I'm got to get one of those things. That was so cool. And so I got one, and the next week I brought it, and I had a couple tunes I learned on it. So I played it for him, and he thought, oh, that's good, you know. And I had kind of a junky one. So he says, let me tell you what you need to get. And so he kind of gave me some ideas. But anyway, it was a long friendship, and so that's what inspired me to get this thing. And I'd like to play you a little set of tunes, and it's probably appropriate that we just followed My Heart Will Go On, that was from the Titanic movie. The first tune I'm going to play for you is called The Blarney Pilgrim, which is in that movie. When they have the dance scene where they're having a party and there's dancers going around and stuff, that's the tune that's played behind them in the movie, I believe. So, anyway, there's that to start off. Then The Lancer. And then the final one is... Why am I forgetting the last one each time? Oh, Out on the Ocean. Thank you.
The next two hymns, Morning Has Broken and Be Thou My Vision, are two of the best loved and most performed Irish hymns. Morning Has Broken is based on the tune Bunessan, which is named after the village of Bunessan in the Ross of Mull, Scotland. It was first used and published as The Morning Has Broken in 1931. It became super popular when folk singer Cat Stevens covered it in 1971. Tonight's arrangement for jazz ensemble is in the style of a jazz waltz with a fugue in the middle. Here is Morning Has Broken. I think it was at the end of last school year, during the summer, Emily Souser came to me, and she was, I'm not sure all how it went down, but she was interested in starting a group of some sort, and she really took the lead on it, and before we know it, we were looking at starting a woodwind quintet, and they started rehearsing some over the summer, came up with the name, they are the Aeolus Woodwind Quintet, and we're excited to feature them on tonight's concert. The song they're going to play, Be Thou My Vision, is based on a Middle Irish poem and set to the tune Slane. Slane is the location where St. Patrick challenged the local pagan Druids with Christianity. The photo used tonight for the Be Thou My Vision shows the ruins of the Friary Church on the hill of Slane. And once we get set up, we'll welcome them on. Thank you.
All right. As they're changing up the stage here, we are, because it's mandated here, going to be picking up an offering after the next song. Give you a little bit of time to pull out your envelopes. And you see the theme is green. So please put green checks, credit cards, whatever, into the music envelope. We will be coming through and picking up the offering during or after the next song or two. Just want to encourage you, your level of giving needs to be kind of in proportion with the level of green you wore or did not wear. The less green you have on, the higher the amount needs to be, because I don't see a lot of green out here. I see beautiful green up here. There you go. There we go. My wife made sure I had this on. Awesome. There you go. You're off the hook. But parents aren't. So, you know, there you go. So just want to encourage you to help offset the cost for an incredible concert like this. Thank you.
One more hand for the Aeolus Woodwind Quintet, yes. I am so proud of what they have done already this year. Just, I don't know if it was a week ago or 2 weeks ago, it kind of runs together, but they did a full concert for the Golden Buckeyes, and it was amazing. They, not just Woodwind Quintet, but they sang, and it was just great, so I'm so proud of them. The next tune. The Bonnie Banks or Loch Lomond, or just Loch Lomond for short, is a Scottish song that features Loch Lomond, the largest Scottish loch or lake. In Scots, Bonnie means attractive, beloved, or dear. This summer, I ordered an arrangement for jazz band, because it was kind of hard to come up with Celtic tunes for jazz band. This one was by Sammy Nestico. It was kind of a blind ordering. I didn't have a recording or a demo, but when it came, it had all these extra instrumental parts that normally aren't included in a jazz band piece, but it had a condensed score. So for those of you, most scores look like this, and every line is a different instrument. So as a conductor, you learn how to read it. Well, a condensed score, there was only two lines. And it had all these extra parts, and I had no idea what was going on. So I was deciding what to do, so I sent it to Steve and said, hey, can you make us a traditional jazz band arrangement of this without all these extra parts? And he was a little confused of where to even start, too. So what we ended up doing, I sent him all the parts. So there's a lot of parts. So every person on the stage is playing their own part. I sent them all to him, and he entered them all in the computer, which is a lot of work. Which created me a full score, which I can see what everyone is doing. So after he did that, we just decided to go ahead and do it with all the parts. So tonight, we're completely filling out this score, Loch Lomond by Sammy Nestico, and that's why we have some extras on the stage. And I thank them for coming and being part of tonight, and you, their parents coming out and supporting it. So without any further ado, we're going to play the full arrangement of Loch Lomond by Sammy Nestico. Thank you. The music of Glenn Miller has always been a favorite of the SVA stage band, and after starting the school year, I was sensing a need to add some big band music to our repertoire. So I Googled Glenn Miller in Ireland and came up with the idea of featuring a set of music from Glenn Miller's historic World War II visit to Belfast, Ireland. The account goes that just after lunch on Sunday, August 13, 1944, Captain Glenn Miller and the dance band, minus the string section, of the American band of the AEF were picked up by two C-47 transport aircraft at RAF Twinwood Farm just outside Bedford and flown to the vast air depot at Langford Lounge, some 15 miles from Belfast in Northern Ireland. Their flight took 1.5 hours. After landing at Langford Lodge, they quickly packed their equipment and instruments into trucks and they were driven by road into Belfast. Between 4:45 and 5:45 p.m., Miller and the band gave a concert at the American Red Cross Club, located in the former Plaza Ballroom on Chichester Street. The club was packed with an audience of 1,200 enlisted personnel and members of the general public. After the concert, the band was transported directly to Langford Lounge, where, after dinner, they performed for several hundred personnel in the camp cinema. Also, the story goes that Glenn Miller took time out to worship in the Gartree Parish Church on Loch Ness Shore. While at the church, Glenn sat down at the organ and treated worshipers to his version of hymns like Abide With Me, as well as many of his hits. The little pedal organ, whose ivories Miller tinkled, is still there and played on special occasions. The organ is now looked on as a valuable collector's item, but the parish will never part with it. Only weeks later that same year, Glenn Miller's plane was lost in the fog over the English Channel on a flight to Paris. The SVA stage band will now finish up tonight's concert with a set of tunes you might have heard at those concerts that day 79 years ago in Northern Ireland that we are calling Glenn Miller in Belfast. Before that, a set of whistle tunes by Steve Martin.
Donald was talking about the last piece we just did and how challenging it was to put all that together. But I can't go past that without mentioning Tony Prima's arrangement of the Yes, We Have No Bananas song. I first heard about that tune when I was a young boy and at my uncle's house, and he sang the beginning of that. He says, Yes, we have no bananas. We have no bananas today. But that's all he knew. And I never heard any more of it since. But every now and then I would be like, I wonder how the rest of that goes. And then Donald ordered that for me to write for him. So I went on the internet, trusty YouTube, and pulled up Tony Prima's version of it. And that's what I used to create that piece. I can't tell you how hard it is to hear all the different instruments on a 1949 recording. It's not stereo, and everything's kind of mushed together, but I went through piece by piece. Okay, there's this trumpet part. Okay, there's the drums. There's a saxophone thing. There's, you know, pretty soon. And that's the reward I get. When I get the whole thing done, it's like putting together one of those 2,000-piece jigsaw puzzles, and then when it's finally done, that last piece snaps in. It's even a greater treat to get to come and play with you on it and see the folks that I wrote for. How neat is that? Thank you so much. You did a great job. Give them a hand for that. So, I played on the banjo three tunes, and I'm going to give you a little information about the Irish music. They're not all the same styles. The first tune set that I played were called reels, R-E-E-L-S. The next set I did on the concertina were jigs. Now, what's the difference between a jig and a reel? basically, the easy way to remember it is that a jig is in a three count, and the word jig has three letters in it. The reel is in a four count, which the word reel is four letters. So if you remember that, when you're playing a reel, you're going digga 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 digga, or da 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 da, that kind of a thing. But when you have the jig, you got 1 2 3, 1 2 3, 1 2 3, 1 2 3. You hear all these triplet kind of things going on, okay? And what I'm going to play for you now is a little mix of things. The first is actually a song. She went to the fair, or I think that's the name. She moved through the fair. That's it. And then Tom Billy's is going to be a jig. And then the last one, the Sally Gardens, is going to be a reel. So it's going to be changing as the tunes go by. So I hope you enjoy it. Playing on one of the smallest instruments I own, the penny whistle. You want some more history? The reason they call it a penny whistle is because back in the day, mid-1800s, I believe, they discovered that it was faster and quicker and more accurate if they took a sheet of tin and rolled it up into a roll, poked the holes in a predetermined spot where they figured was the best, and thus, because it was made out of tin, they called those tin whistles as well, and they sold them for a penny each. So that was the penny whistle. There you go.
Thank you.
So I've already introduced the next songs. But before we get to them, again, thanks so much for coming out tonight. I think huge thanks to Steve. I think you got the most precise, accurate description of Irish sessions that you could ask for. If you glean that, you know what they're all about now. Again, we're going to end tonight with what it might be like to have been at one of Glenn Miller's concerts in 1944 in Belfast. Here is Glenn Miller in Belfast.
Thank you.
would you like to swing on a star and carry moonbeams home in a jar and be better off than you are? Or would you rather be a mule? A mule is an animal with fun, funny ears. He kicks up at anything he hears. His back is brawny and his brain is weak. He's just plain stupid with a stubborn streak. And by the way, if you hate to go to school, you may grow up to be a mule. Or would you like to swing on a star and carry moonbeams home in a jar and be better off than you are? Or would you rather be a pig? A pig is an animal with dirt on his face. His shoes are a terrible disgrace. He's fat and lazy and extremely rude. Has no manners when he eats his food. But if you don't care a feather or a fig, you may grow up to be a pig. Or would you like to swing on a star and carry moonbeams home in a jar and be better off than you are? Or would you rather be a fish? A fish is an animal that swims in a brook. He can't write his name or read a book. To fool the people is his only thought. Although he's slippery, he still gets caught. But if that sort of life is what you wish, you may grow up to be a fish. And all the monkeys down in the zoo, every day you see quite a few. So you see, it's all up to you. You could be swinging on a star.
Thank you.
Here we go. Got it? Guys, you did a fantastic job. I got to tell you, every time I hear you guys perform, it gives me great hope that you'll remember where all your stuff is tomorrow in class. These guys look so sharp, and yet we can't figure out where our sweater goes later. That's okay. There's hope. There's hope. There's hope. Guys, just again, let's give them another round of applause for such an incredible, awesome evening. All right. That wraps it up for this evening. Mr. Huff, if you can come out here real quick, we want to give you a big thank you also as we conclude. Incredible job once again. Let's have a word of prayer as we then head on home. Let's bow our heads. Lord, thank you for this incredible evening. You have blessed us with incredible gifts and talented, and I want to thank you and each of these students here today for sharing that gift and talent with us this evening. Keep us safe as we go home. Let us get a good night's rest and refreshed and ready for another week. In your name, amen. Thank you very much, guys.
My mother was a Catholic girl from County Cork, was she? They were married in two churches, lived happily enough until the day that I was born, and things got rather tough. Oh, it is the biggest mix-up that you have ever seen. My father, he was orange, and my mother, she was green.